Yeah, welcome once again to Research Methods. Today we are discussing research proposal, which is something very interesting that everybody has to do as part of his long essay or dissertation or thesis. Any researcher beginning a research has to somehow write a research proposal. So today we are going to go through the components of a research proposal. Then we'll go beyond that to discuss how to be able to write a research abstract and also how to be able to conclude a long essay or a thesis that you'll be writing. Okay, so our session overview focuses on the guidelines for writing a research proposal. I'll begin by looking at the components of a research proposal, the conclusion of a research study, and then writing an abstract. These are the things I will be discussing today. Interestingly, most often students know that they have to write research proposals, but they think that they can jump it. But this is something that we're not going to jump, we're going to get it done. We are looking at chapter 8 of our book Research Made Easy, and then I hope that you can be able to read it in addition to the videos that you are watching. So components of a research proposal. A research proposal plays a prime role or a key role in every research process. It kind of articulates what you are going to do in your research and how you are going to get it done. Some authors argue that the supervisor reads your research proposal to have an understanding of what you have said you want to do. And sometimes some students are afraid because they think it's a written academic contract, but technically it is. Even though there's flexibility that you can change the blueprint as you go on, it's not a legal one, but it's between the researcher and then the research supervisor. Detailing what the researcher intends to do, that is one, and how he intends to go about it, and how he plans on interpreting the results, or what are some of the potential outcomes of the results. So it is not a fixed blueprint. It doesn't mean that if you write your research proposal, you can't change it. If you write a research proposal, there's likelihood that you can also change it as you go on. Because remember, I mentioned in episode 1 that the research process is an iterative process. Sometimes you start, even your title can change. You may start and even your location for collecting data can change. But irrespective of both of them, you need to still have a research proposal to give you some guideline how you're going to get it done. Even helps the supervisor to supervise you. In an environment like the University of Ghana Business School, the research proposal plays a key role in helping select which supervisor should supervise you. Because when it's given to the lecturers in the department, they can look at the title and look at maybe your introduction and your research problem and know whether they are interested in supervising you. So research proposal is necessary. Good. Now, the minimum core is the minimum core intellectual contribution of the research is set within your research proposal. So sometimes there's a section in the research proposal called research significance. That helps us to understand what is the potential significance of your research if you should finish, or implications of your research if you should finish. How does it look like? Research proposal is an outline of what you are going to carry out in your research. If you compare it carefully with the research, your research chapter 1 outline, that's if you should, your research proposal is accepted. It has a relationship. The proposal has a number of different components. You have the introduction, which comprises of your research background, problem, and purpose. Then you have the research objectives, questions, significance of research, literature review, research methodology, which is your proposed research methodology, your research limitations, project schedule, pre-chapter outline, and references. If you compare to chapter 1, we are just dropping, if you remove your literature review and the project schedule, you get your chapter 1. So anytime you get your research proposal accepted, you have actually written your chapter 1 already. That is why it's necessary that as a student, when you are doing your long essay, you make sure that when your first research proposal, you put in much effort, because it's just closer to your chapter 1. An accepted research proposal can be converted to your chapter 1. That actually leads you to go to chapter 2. It means that you actually speed up your time of finishing your work. So your research proposal plays a very key role. Let's look at the different components for each of them. We'll take them one by one. Okay. So starting with the research background. A research background gives an introduction to a research issue. It gives an overview of what you are going to do, usually from the practitioner perspective, by using some statistics about the phenomenon you want to study or how practice sees it. But the objective of the background is to establish a point that there's a need to do a research on the topic that you are trying to research on. It's not the research problem. So as of here, they want to imply a question, but not necessarily state the question. Imply the question. It will examine some of the current discourses and progress concerning the issue you're trying to study. So let's take an example here. This is an example of a research background, social networking in the workplace. Now, it tries to give you an overview of what is social networking in the workplace and some of the contemporary issues that are coming up from practice. So it begins by saying that social networking is increasingly becoming a phenomenon in the social and business lifestyles of employees. So it has opened up. Statistics from the 2011 Forbes report on social networking and business stated that 85% of workers in America spend a minimum of 30 minutes working hours to visit social networking websites. What has it done? It has given you some global statistic on the issue, a statistic from a developed country. Then it goes on to say that these statistics are not too far from that of Africans, bringing it home to Africa. And it says that as a recent study in South Africa found 70% of South African workers interviewed browse Facebook during the working hours. Then again, beyond the concern on the growth on the issue of in the use of social networking platforms in the workplace, there has been concerns about implications it has on both employers and employees. While some employers have been reported to requesting access passwords to employee accounts, some others are exploring policies and strategies to leverage social media in sales and marketing. Now, a number of issues have been lifted up here. First of all, it points out that the social networking is becoming a phenomenon in the social and business lifestyles of employees in the US and that even in South Africa. So one key thing that you can find out here is that anytime you are doing a research background, it's good to give a background about the issue, maybe from a global perspective of a different country which is not in Africa, then narrow down to Africa. The reason why these two different geographic locations are important is that it shows that your research issue is not just about Ghana or it's not just about Kenya. It's more than just about being Africa. I know that there are some research issues that are just specific about Africa, but as you are trying to situate your work as a business researcher in a business school or even as a development researcher in a development school of development, one thing that you should try to do is that try to position your work in an environment that it looks like it's not just about the context that you live in, but there is something concerning the issue you want to research on. So that's what the author tries to do. And he goes that somehow businesses have to respond to this growing phenomena. However, the questions are, should employees be concerned? What are the potential risks and benefits of social networking in the workplace? And how can businesses address these risks? Very set up the case for the issue. So it has implied a question here, but doesn't mean that will be the core question he's trying to answer. But it gives you an understanding that this is what the work is about. A good way of presenting your research background is to make sure you end with what the work is about. So sometimes somebody will say that it tries to respond to this issue, or it tries to respond to these questions. Then it will move from the business problem and then go to the research problem in the next step. So your research background has a link with your research problem. So someone can say that your research background is a presentation of your business problem. Your research problem is a situation or a need of a solution, an improvement or an iteration, or a discrepancy between the way things are the way things ought to be. But because the word is research problem, the problem is in the research. Hence, we expect that in your study, you are trying to locate a problem that exists in the research. The research problem is a build-up or a summation of gaps you have found in the literature. So when you have found your business problem, you step away from your business problem and go into a research problem. For example, if your business problem is about declining employee productivity, when you go and research in your research work from different research publications and journals articles, you may realize that some studies have been done on that particular area about declining employee productivity, and you realize that it could be that some researchers have found out that the issue about declining employee productivity has to do with job design. Somebody will say it has to do with economic issues like salary and bonuses. So which of them do you want to research on? Maybe when you look into the text concerning Africa and Ghana, job design has not really received much attention. So it is of necessity for you as a researcher to step into and look into, explore the impact of job design on employee productivity. And that could be a starting point. Another person will say that, no, I want to just do a comprehensive set of factors by looking at what are the characteristics of productive employees. That's a different question. So for every business problem. There could be 1,001 research questions that comes out of research gaps that you may find concerning it. Good. So let's look at an example here. This is another example on social networking, but in the public sector in PepsiCo. But this is not the research background. It's more of a research problem. So he's going to point out a gap in the research. He begins by saying that adoption of social media by government confronts a series of barriers. What is he trying to do? He's trying to situate the study that when you look at social networking in the public sector or by use by governments, there are some challenges that governments have to surmount. And he goes on to list some of these challenges. The barriers include relate to records management, privacy issues, accuracy, and administration specific requirements. Then spend some time releasing some different two or three sentences to illustrate the different challenges that governments may face. After he has done this, he says that although the use of social media in Mexican state government portals is recent, when we say something is recent, it means that it has now coming of age. It means that it has not yet received maturity. Sometimes the way people write gaps or authors write gaps in research problems is to show that there's a discrepancy. Something is a shortfall of something, or is yet to reach maturity. So he's saying that there is few works or few knowledge. There's little knowledge about how social media should be used by Mexican state government, and he said that it's recent. The development of social relationships or relationship between government and citizens is growing fast. It is recent, but it's evolving. In practice, government is building some relationships with citizens on social media. So we need to understand how to do it better. So then it goes on to say that, however, in contrast with other countries, what is it doing? It's trying to show you a context gap that between Mexico and other countries, there is, to our knowledge, there is still no guideline for the use of social media in Mexico. That means that other countries, maybe the US, maybe Canada, around Mexico, have policies, have strategies to be able to, for government to be able to leverage social media, but that of Mexico doesn't have it. So he said that a study of perceived risk, benefits, and strategies will be helpful in the development of those guidelines. So what is the study about? The study has pointed out that if social media confronts barriers to governments, number two, Mexico as a Mexican state government is yet to understand how to use social media and leverage it very well in its relationship with its citizens. Number three, there is still no guideline or strategic document to guide the government in doing so. So my study will try to give us some direction on that. That is all that the person is saying. So you see, it is built logically. First of all, social media confronts barriers for governments worldwide. Secondly, Mexico, you are trying to build relationship with your consumers very fast. Third, you don't have any strategy to do so. So there is a need for a study to help you get that strategy. Another example two. This is corporate governance and financial decisions of Ghanaian listed firms. Corporate governance has been identified in previous studies to influence firms' financing or capital structure decisions, which also affect performance. So it's trying to tell an importance. Most often, research gaps always try to use their first two sentences to establish that the topic is important. So if we don't address challenges to the topic, there will be an issue. So that's what it has done here. These empirical studies tended to focus mainly on developed economies with inconclusive results. These studies have been done, but they focus on developed economies with inconclusive results. Now, when we say something has focused on one area, it means that it's at the discrepancy of another. And when you say that something has not been done in developing, it means that it may not be done in developed, but there's need for studies in developing. But this gentleman here is writing that there has been focus on developed economies with inconclusive results. It means that even before you move to developing economies, the studies on developed economies is inconclusive. There's room for what? Clarification. There's room for more studies. Then very little, when it says very little, it's a discrepancy. Very little, however, has been done on corporate governance in sub-Saharan Africa, especially with respect to firms financing decisions. In Ghana, for instance, see, he has established the global one, then gone to where? to Africa before it goes to in Ghana. In Ghana, for instance, economic development and restructuring have introduced modern forms of business activity and diverse financing structures like Ghana Stock Exchange. Whenever you have a stock exchange, you are increasing the financing options for firms, because when they go on it, they can be able to put their shares and stocks on it, on display for people to be able to do what? To be able to buy stocks from them and buy shareholders to be able to come into the company. So firms' financing decisions will increase when stock exchange comes. Hence, it means that Ghanaian firms are being exposed to more financing options than previously. It is therefore crucial to determine how current issues in corporate governance affect the financing decisions of Ghanaian firms. Then he goes on to state the purpose of the study. This paper, or this study, specifically examines the relationship between various variables of corporate governance and capital structure decisions of firms listed on Ghana Stock Exchange during the six-year period, 1998 to 2003. Very specific of what he wants to do. Gaps come together to form a research problem. Out of the research problem that you build, one of the gaps, you may try to address it. He didn't say he's going to address the gap on developed economies. He wants to address the gap on the fact that developing economies need more studies. That's what he chose. The one you choose to do becomes your research purpose or agenda. That is why you see that after everything he wrote, he said, this paper specifically does this. So that one becomes his research purpose. So from your research problem, you go to your research purpose, a concise statement of specific goal or aim of your study. When you have a research purpose, you are pointing out that this is what I want to do. In among all the gaps are presented, I've chosen this particular gap to address. And that is what he's saying here. Social networking in Mexico has a gap. And out of it, he pointed out the study seeks to explore perceived risk and benefits of social media among public servants from Mexico, and especially the strategic elements to include in social media in e-government policy and as a communication channel with citizens. So there are three things he wants to do: perceived risks, perceived benefits, and strategies to be able to include social media in government policy. Then you also see that you have corporate governance and financing decisions of Ghanaian listed firms. This study examines the relationship between various variables of corporate governance and capital structure decisions of firms listed on Ghana Stock Exchange during the six-year period. Each of them is specific of mentioning their goal and their aim. Specific goal and aim. The research purpose and problem statement. When you have done your research purpose, the next thing that usually comes up is to go move to your objective. But let me just take a minute to explain something. There are some schools of thought about the word called problem statement. Sometimes in some universities, when you see problem statement, it means that the person doesn't have a research problem. He rather builds a research problem and adds the purpose to it and calls it the problem statement. In some other universities, you see that the outline of the long essay has a research problem and problem statement. In that scenario, the problem statement is equal to the research purpose. They just want a statement from the problem that you have chosen to do. So you get it, it depends on your university. Some institutions, the problem statement is the research problem plus the purpose. In other institutions, the problem statement is equal to the research purpose. In fact, in other institutions, there's even they may not use the word research problem or even research problem statement. They use research rationale, which is the same thing as a research problem. So please just be conversant with the different terminologies that are used by different supervisors and different universities. Okay. So the purpose of a study always has to try to establish what, who, and when, and for what purpose. What I'm trying to say is that there are some number of things that we need to see in your purpose. We should see the scope of your study, how far you are going. That means that this guy said Mexico, this gentleman said Ghana, and then he even stated a year period. This one said public servants. So the scope and the focus should be there. You can't just say that your purpose of study is to just explore perceived risks of social media. Where? So your purpose, you see, when you say purpose, it means that there is a definite statement about where you are going, and that is needed in the work. Because out of your purpose, we expect you to generate your objective, which are more specific sub-statements that emanate from your purpose, that originate from your purpose. In some universities, they may not have a purpose. They may have what they call a general objective. So the general objective in that case is the same as your purpose. Then they ask you for halfway, they ask you to outline your sub-objectives. And that is what you may call your objectives here. So please just be careful about the different universities. So your purpose will help you to lead to your research objective. So your research problem will generate a direction to your purpose, and then to then give you direction for your research objective. More specific focus statements and questions that communicate in greater detail the nature of your study. So let's look at an example. Mandated drug testing programs in high schools. A case of a Ghanaian high school. This is somebody's study. Now, the purpose of the study is to investigate the attitudes of high school students to mandated drug testing programs in Kwewu Senior High School. So that is the purpose. Out of it, he has two objectives. First, to explore the nature of adoption of mandated drug testing programs by high school, Kwewu Senior High School. And in that case, what the nature is trying to do is establish why did they adopt it? What led to the adoption? Is it a policy? And how many people have signed on to if it's a policy? And what is the adoption? Is lectures being educated or students being educated? You just explain the nature or describe the nature of the adoption. The other one is to explore the differences between the males and females. Do you realize that this is actually what the person wants to do? But before he can lead on to this, he needs to give us a background. That's why he has a nature question. After that, he goes to the differences. So if you are doing a quantitative study in this, you see that most of the questions here will be very descriptive tables. Trying to explain how many lectures were educated on this, how many teachers were educated on this, how many students were educated on this. Then here he will try to look at the differences in male and female or gender differences between concerning the drug testing programs. Maybe if you have got two types of drug testing programs, maybe for cocaine, marijuana, and for things, there may be different students may have different attitudes towards all the drug testing programs. So this is, and maybe there could be even issues concerning parents and their views concerning this drug testing. Maybe parents don't want their children to be tested. So what are the views that come up? So you can look at, you can explore some of these things in the nature. Then when you get to the number two, you look at the differences between their attitudes towards the drug testing. Do males like it more than the females? Maybe males are more receptive to AIDS tests, but they're not receptive to let's say marijuana test. Okay. And you could also explore why. Good. Now, let's look at another one. This social network in Mexico, the one we were looking at earlier. The purpose was stated earlier, but look at the objectives. Three objectives are here: benefits, risk, and strategy. Benefits, risk, and then strategy. So you see that all the different elements in the purpose are outlined in where? Objectives. In fact, somebody may even argue that this student is not being more specific. You should say to explore benefits of social media in Mexican government. You should add the Mexico so that the scope is very clear or the focus is very clear. There's clarity and there's no ambiguity of where we are trying to do it. But see, now we have the objective, the purpose here, so it links up to the objective directly. Now, does it mean that every study will have an objective? It's always important that your studies have objective. Otherwise, where are you going? And even helps you to be able to break down your work into a logical process of carrying out the data collection. It means that the student has to collect data on benefits, data on risk, and then what? Data on strategies. The student also has to do a review on benefits, review on risk, and review on what? Strategies. That is why it is always good to break down your objectives. Now, the next thing is that you move to the research question. The research question usually tries to answer a number of things. What you ask, how you ask, and where you look. So if you look at your research questions, there should be some focus on where you are carrying your study from and what you want to do there, and if possible, how you are going to do that. That's later on. So research questions are interrogative statements that focus on what variables, you see, and concepts that are to be described and what relationship might exist among them. So social networking in Mexico, what are the potential benefits? What are the main risks? What are the strategic guidelines required? So all these things are response to each of the questions. It is always advisable that for a long essay for an undergrad or a master's student, you don't do more than three questions. Because when you have more questions, it puts a lot of stress on you as a student to satisfy and answer all of them. So I recommend doesn't mean that it is written as a blueprint and it cannot be argued against. But I recommend that you maximum three, maybe have your minimum to be two or preferably two. But if you have maximum three, you are going to answer all the three questions. The more questions you ask, the more we want you to answer them. We expect you to answer them. But you need to also understand that questions have to be focused, have to have clarity, and have to be complex in nature to satisfy the components of a research question. If your research question is not clear, it might be ambiguous to others. If it has not got a focus or a scope, people will be asking that, where are you doing the study? If it is not complex, it means that anybody can answer it. In fact, just a Google answer will answer it. For example, a student who gets up in the morning and says, I want to do a study on unemployment in Ghana. Don't you realize that current issues in the country and even discussions on radio, anybody even in high school can answer that question? Or maybe factors that influence unemployment in Ghana. Because he can see unemployment on the street all the time. But if you make it much more complex, like factors that influence female unemployment in the extractive industry in Ghana, maybe that to me is more difficult to answer than just from what you feel or what you just observe within society. So we expect you to have very good questions. Now let's take them one by one. Clarity means that you should remove all ambiguity in the question. A strong research question should never leave room for ambiguity. Like a question that says, why are social networking websites harmful? Now, who are you saying the thing is harming? And it also presupposes that you began the study with the objective that social networking websites are harmful. And which social networking website are you referring to? Because there are a number of them, and it doesn't mean that all of them are harmful. So a much more a question with better clarity will be, how are online users experiencing or addressing privacy issues on social networking websites as MySpace and Facebook? There is a focus and scope. The person is also telling you the type of harm he's looking at, and you tell me who are the target people, online users. So this is quite better than the other one. Clarity and focus means that the question is not too broad, so that it may take you about 3 years or a textbook to finish it. Like a question of what is the effect of environment on global warming? That's a very big issue. That needs textbooks to be able to answer it. But if you look at it here, focus question, how is glacial melting affecting penguins in Antarctica? Focus. There's a target group. And then there's a particular element or what variable you are trying to look at. Questions that are too simple and are complex enough. How are doctors addressing diabetes in US? This is like a journalistic question. You put it in Google, it may give you answers. So what are the common traits of those suffering from diabetes in America? And how can these commonalities be used to aid medical community in prevention of the disease? A little bit more complex. Good. We don't want your question to be answered by a few factual sentences. That when we just Google them, some facts in the Google or table in Google can just answer the question. We want you to have some degree of complexity to your question. Very, very important. Now, so going back, the purpose of this study is to investigate the attitudes of high school students to mandated drug testing programs in Kwewu Senior High School. Research objectives: explore the nature, explore the differences. What is the nature and what are the differences? See, all the questions and objectives are linked up together. This is how we expect you to do your research. And the next question of your or component of your research proposal is what we call the literature review. The literature review plays a very key role in giving you guidance on what literature you are reading in order to complete your long essay. So before you start your long essay, in your research proposal, your objective of having a literature review to show the lecturer who is going to potentially supervise you that you have an idea of some of the literature that is relevant to your work. And even if there are others that you have not mentioned, can he point you to that direction? So it's important that you do this section. The literature review section in a research proposal often seeks to explain concepts behind the research. What is your definition for poverty if you are doing a study on poverty? What is your definition for unemployment if you are doing a study on unemployment? What is your definition for microenterprise if you are doing a study on microenterprise? So all the key concepts should be explained so that we know where you are taking off from. And to present a theoretical approach to addressing those questions, if there be. This is often difficult for new researchers as they may not be sure of the theoretical approach or the factors they are going to use for their study. So as a rule of thumb, introduce the relevant literature that will govern the area that you're going to do your study in and the possible factors. So let's look at an example here. I'll examine this. This is about mobile phones and micro trading. This study investigates the impact of mobile phones and micro trading of women traders in Ghana. So it states out the purpose of the study first. To obtain answers to this objective or the general objective, four strands of literature will be reviewed, and which is very interesting because there's literature on mobile phones, micro trading, and then maybe say women traders are still traders. So let's see what he's saying here. The first strand is we'll explore the concept of trading from the perspective of transaction cost theory. Transaction cost theory is arguably the most commonly used theory in studying issues relating to assessment of impact of technology on commerce and trade. Transaction costs are described by the cost of running a system. The study will examine the impact of mobiles on the cost involved in micro trading. So it makes sense. The second and third strands of the literature will review features of mobile phones. It makes sense. And benefits of mobile phones. It makes sense. The fourth strand will examine the impact of mobile phones generated by virtue of benefits. Of the benefits. Mobile phones are conceptualized to have three effects. So it's now picking another model. The first one is incremental, transformational, and production. So it gives a reference to it. These effects will be used to analyze the impact of the mobile phones on trade. It has finished and told you all that it's going to cover. It has given you direction on the type of effects or impact it's looking at. It's told you the benefits is going, it's told that it's going to look at research literature on benefits and then literature on features of mobile phones. And it has also emphasized the theory it's going to use. That is what you do in a literature review. From there, you go to your research methodology. Your proposed research methodology. Now, in this area, what are you going to do? Three key things. What type of study are you carrying out? Quantitative, qualitative. What is your unit of analysis? Individual, household, organization, industry, or groups. This has to be made clear. What research strategy are you using? If you are going quantitative, are you doing survey or experiment? Or if you are doing qualitative, are you doing case study or ethnography? These things should be mentioned. Where will data be collected, or where data will be collected, and what methods will be used? What's your study population? Is it a school? Is it a university? And primary data, are you collect your primary data by interviews or observation or questionnaires? And then secondary data, view industry reports or any company documents or reports from some of the institutions that you'll be interviewing for your research. Is that what you are going to do? That's something that you are asking yourself. An example, gender differences in e-banking adoption. The study will use a quantitative approach to study the gender differences in the adoption of e-banking services among university students. So the target group is very clear. But why are we looking at that target group? Or which particular university students are we looking into? We are looking at the study population of University of Ghana Business School. Then a study by Texan 2009 found that students enrolled in finance and accounting programs are more likely to adopt e-banking services. Hence, a survey will be carried out on a sample selected from students in third and fourth year enrolled in finance and accounting programs. Why third and fourth year? They may have gained the maturity in using these e-banking platforms by the time they got to third and fourth year, because they have finished the first 2 years of their university when they open an account, ideally. Then a questionnaire concerning the adoption and use of e-banking services will be administered to 150 students. So it's mentioning that. The study will also examine statistics on student banking activity from campus bank. On campus in the University of Ghana, there are banks. So you can consult the banks for secondary data. How many of the students' accounts here have signed up to e-banking services? When did they sign it up for it? Is it in their first year or the second year when they open the account? So that could even give you some fresh perspectives on the issue. Do students sign up for e-banking services as soon as they open their account, or they come back later after they have been convinced by a friend? So that could also give you some information. And sometimes the banks also do surveys. They ask them who recommended you. So you can also get those statistics from the bank. So that's why it's important to go to the campus banks to get some secondary information. Then you go to significance of the research. Significance usually tries to point out the potential implications of your study. And now that you are beginning, what is the potential significance to research, to policy and practice? How will it inform these three strands of knowledge? How will it inform them? So in an example, we can look at this. E-banking in rural banks. The significance of the study can be viewed along three strands: research, policy, practice, and policy. Concerning research significance, now the author says that the study goes beyond current research on e-banking in rural banks by examining the strategies for implementing and integrating e-banking technologies. Literature on the strategic perspective on e-banking in rural banks is arguably non-existent on Ghana and perhaps spread to the West African region. So what you do in your research of significance is to establish your problem, and what you see your problem, you did, you found the gap you found in your research problem that you're addressing. You are, by addressing that gap, you are contributing to research, or you're contributing to research literature. So by doing so, if you finish this study, you have actually answered a question in research, and that is what the student here is emphasizing here, that by carrying out this research, I am adding on to the lack of, I'm trying to reduce the lack of e-banking literature in West Africa. That's what he said here. And even that of Ghana, which is non-existent. So I'm adding new knowledge. I'm giving new perspective. I'm opening up our minds to understand that what are the benefits or what are the challenges of e-banking in rural banks in Ghana. Concerning significance to practice, the study will provide guidelines to rural banks on factors which influence e-banking adoption and strategic options to address challenges in managing and sustaining e-banking applications. So this will be very helpful to ARB, Apex Bank, and to rural banks in the next network. ARB, Apex Bank is the institution in Ghana that governs rural banks, especially in their computerization. So when you conduct a study on e-banking in a rural bank, you are more likely to lend wisdom and knowledge that will be of benefit to ARB, Apex Bank. That's the practical implications. However, ARB, Apex Bank's initiatives are sponsored by the Millennium Challenge Corporation, which is some fund agency in Ghana. It's an international fund agency globally, and they have given some funds to Ghana. So in that Millennium Challenge account has been played a critical role in supporting e-banking or computerization of rural banks in Ghana. So it says that in terms of policy, the study will provide feedback on policies driving computerization of rural banks, which is critical to the operations of the financier. The global institution in Ghana who is financing rural banks computerization is called the Millennium Challenge Corporation. So, and the government of Ghana, they are doing it in collaboration. So any other donor to which in partnership will benefit from this particular kind of study in terms of policy. These contributions to practice and policy will become necessary to the development of more advanced or complex functionalities for rural banks, including the internet banking and mobile banking. Okay. Then from there you go to limitations. What are the limitations of research? Sometimes students hear what limitations and delimitations and they come confused about it. Which one comes first and which one is which? Limitations are the influences that the researcher cannot control. They are shortcomings and contributions or conditions that influence your study. Sometimes it can come to it, your analysis approach, the nature of any type of limitation influence your analysis approach, the nature of self-reporting, the instruments you use, where you do your sample. So sometimes even your constraints, financial constraints, because of that you couldn't interview more than 200 people. It is limitation. Or sometimes you chose to do it convenient sampling within business school because you couldn't go beyond business school. Limitation. So this is, you cannot control, because sometimes the things are beyond you. On the other hand, delimitations are subtracted limitations. What do I mean by that? The ones that you make a choice of, because of specific reason, you make a choice of. So limit your delimitation to things that the reader expects you to reasonably do, but you don't do. Things that we're expecting you to do, you didn't do, usually become your delimitations. For example, it describes the boundaries you have set for the study. The things that you are going to do and you're not going to do, the literature you are going to review and not going to review, the population you are not going to study and you are not going to study, or the methodological procedures you will use or not use. So here is much more about what you will not do because of some reason. But the other one is what is constraining you from doing something. So get it right. In every long essay, you have to point out your limitations and delimitations. But sometimes some students combine everything under the word limitations, which is not necessarily bad for or wrong in an environment like this University of Ghana. They put everything under limitations. So sometimes maybe the definitional concept, how you define a particular concept or terminology that you are using in your research, the scope of your study, and the variables that you are not considering. An example of the in the e-banking in rural bank study, this student wrote this: a sample size of 50 computerized RCBs will be selected out of the 97 based on proximity for ease of data collection and time constraint. When you say ease of data collection and time constraint, it's telling you what? It's a limitation. He will be selected based on proximity and ease of data collection. He cannot go across the whole country, so he's constrained. So in that case, it's a limitation. The study will not cover the use of electronic channels such as ATM and point of sale, mobile phone, and internet, since these channels have not been deployed to the banks. Limitation. You have not, he realizes that banks have not yet, rural banks have not started point of sales services or ATM. So if you go, you won't get data. So it's what? A limitation. You are not the, it's constraining you. You are not necessarily setting the constraints yourself. Now, it will only focus on computerization projects under the mandate of ARB APS Bank. That is a delimitation, the choice you are making. Because in rural bank computerization, there are banks who are going under the ARB Bank computerization project, and there are banks who, because of their own money, they don't want to do with the government project. They are doing it on their own. So which of them are you studying? You choose to study the one which is being done by ARB APS Bank, sorry. That's the one that you want to do. But the other ones that the banks are doing themselves, you are not looking to do studies. So it's a choice you are making. So it becomes a delimitation. Good. Also, there's a possibility that some of the respondents may not return their questionnaires. It's obviously a limitation. It's not your fault. It's not, you can't control the return of questionnaires. You can even go and stand by somebody's house and knock 10 times. He can give you an empty questionnaire. Like during my PhD, somebody put the questionnaire back into an envelope and mail it back to me that we are not interested. You see, so that can be returned. Now, the reason why some of the respondents may not return their questionnaires is because you are asking about financial issue and operational performance before and after computerization, and people may not want to give you that information. Then the study will focus more on banks that are more on banks than their customers in assessing challenges and prospects of the project. You are making a choice to interview bank workers, not customers. So it's a choice you are making, so it's a delimitation. So in here we have got about two delimitations, the rest are limitations. Good. Then last part is, last but one is your project schedule, which is the activities you are going to do, usually the chapters you are going to complete and how you are going to complete them and the timelines. So you have to be realistic. Sometimes some students don't realize that they may get married during the dissertation process, and then they write that they will do this by this time, will do this by this time. By the time you realize after chapter 2 he's doing his wedding, by chapter 4 that the time that he's supposed to do chapter 4 he's on honeymoon, so he cannot be able to finish his work. You see, by the time he started the study, when he submitted his proposal, he began counseling, so he knew that this thing he's not going to finish on time. So it will have time required, and you should also consider the fact that sometimes you go and collect data, you don't get what you're looking for. So it could look like this: chapter 1, meeting my supervisor, the key activity, 23rd May. Chapter 2, I'll meet my supervisor and then revision on previous chapters. So it's 2nd June. Chapter 3, meeting my supervisor, revision of previous chapters, and then what? Data collection. So he's putting the activities you'll be doing per that time and giving the time period. So somebody here is completion date, not the period. So the date of completion. Some people put the period there. And then you have meetings with supervisor, revision previous chapter, chapter 4, 6th August, and the same thing on chapter 5 when he's going to conclude. So a very simple way of doing it. We don't want something like this: Christmas in January, I write my research proposal. This, there's no time on it, just writing a month. Literature review, complete literature review, main data collection. See, look at the first time you talk to your supervisor in March. Since he began the study, you talk to the supervisor in March. Is it realistic? Are you supervising yourself or you're supervising the supervisor? Or the supervisor is supervising you. So it doesn't make sense. And you are putting your Christmas time, you want to tell the supervisor that you are breaking for Christmas, so you'll be doing things on your own. For most students, between first semester and second semester, you are supposed to be working and collecting your data by that time. So I expect you to be using Christmas. As soon as Christmas is over, first week in general, you are in the companies, you are administering questionnaires. Otherwise, it will affect your finishing time. Your chapter outline has to do with the fact that what will go into your the outline of your study. So it's just an outline. Chapter one will do what? Chapter two will do what? For example, a student will say that the first chapter comprises research background, problem, research purpose, objectives, and all the other activities or components of chapter one. Chapter two focuses on the review of relevant literature on the overview of health information systems and the research framework. Chapter three entails the context of study, covers the brief overview of the healthcare system in Ghana and the profile of the case setting. It's always important that you have an overview of the healthcare, an overview of the context that you are carrying your study in. Sometimes some students bring it after chapter four, some people bring it before chapter four. The context helps us to understand if a supervisor or an examiner is reading your work and has no idea of Ghana or of the industry, it gives him overview of the industry or where you are collecting your data from. Especially even if you are doing quantitative studies, you can even use the context to give us a background on the sector and then the firm. Like when the firm began, all those information that may be relevant. If it's about a common societal issue, you can even give us a background of the issue concerning how Ghana has positioned itself in terms of policies, if it's entrepreneurs, about those that same phenomenon you're trying to study. It helps to learn understanding. And sometimes you can provide statistics. For example, if you're looking at mobile phone users and you're doing some survey on it, you can use this place to be able to give statistics on who is leading, how many mobile phone companies are there in Ghana. So that when you mention MTN, mobile, and you mention Glo, or you mention Espresso, or you mention Airtel and other companies in your results, people understand and can learn understanding to it that, oh, in the context, he said that there are five companies in Ghana, there are six companies in Ghana. That is why he's showing six companies here. Then you can compare your statistics with what you put in chapter three and then what you put in the chapter after chapter four. That's your findings. Chapter four is your methodological approaches and then the methods you are going to use. Chapter five talks about your data presentation and analysis and discussion. And then your chapter six will conclude. Now, analysis is your themes that you are drawing from your data. Discussion is discussing and linking those themes that you have drawn from your data with the literature you have. So sometimes with qualitative research, you have analysis and discussion always happening at the same time. I'll talk about analysis later. I think we did that in chapter session seven. Now this is just session eight, so you should go back and watch session seven. It will help you. Okay. Conclusion. When anybody finishes, okay, that was about research proposal. So that's the end. Now, whenever anybody finishes a long essay, he needs to write a conclusion. Conclusion is something very daunting for a lot of students. They don't know where to begin from. He is in a hurry to finish. After all these months of working on this, I have to spend much time on this one too. I want to finish. Most often, I advise that your conclusion should be between 1,005 to 2,000 words. Very brief and straight to the point. It can have about three components. So this is the structure of your work. You have introduction, your literature review, context of study that gives us the background of the context where the data is collected from, the research methodology, results and discussion, and conclusion. I was saying earlier that sometimes the context of study can come after the research methodology, or some people even add it to the research methodology. It depends on your supervisor. But let's take it, go into the conclusion. Your conclusion should give us more information about what you're going to, how what you did in your study. Before I mention it, let me just do this recap. When you do your analysis, in here, your results, analysis, and discussion in chapter five, when you do that, what we expect from you as a student is to be able to tell us what does your findings tell you about the research. And then compare your findings with previous studies. So what your findings tells you about the research is about starting the analysis, drawing out some of the key things you can see from the patterns of discussions or respondents that are given to you. Or if there are some tables, what are you seeing from the table? What is significant, what is not significant? After you have done that, you have to start discussing by comparing what you have found in your findings to what previous literature has done. And two things are what you are looking for. You are looking for confirmations and you are looking for contradictions. Confirmations means that what you have found in your from your study, is it confirming anything you said in your literature review or previous studies? And then this contradictions is that, is there a difference between what you found and what you said in chapter 2, your literature review, or what others have done in the previous studies. If there are contradictions, you are required, even quantitative and qualitative researchers, to investigate or probe further what could be the common causes of these differences. Now, these differences could be caused by the sample that you chose, could be caused by the location that you did the study in, because maybe the other study was done in Nigeria and you are doing it in Ghana, so there could be differences in the study. It could also be come from the factors or the way you even ask questions on the field. So your objective is to explore in your discussion what could be the possible reasons of this particular contradiction. And if you find a confirmation, then you can then go to say, this is a reinforced lesson, or a key lesson, or a major lesson I'm getting from the study, that irrespective of the location, this is always green. Because somebody did it in a different place, you have also done it in a different place, and your thing is still remaining green. So irrespective of the location, green would always be green. Or whatever you are studying will always be green. So that's what you are doing here. What do you, what your findings tell you about your research? Are there contradictions? Why do the contradictions exist? What are the key and new lessons? Key lessons are usually confirmed findings. Something that has been confirmed. So they become key. They become much more relevant. And the new lessons are something that is coming new from your work. Either through contradictions or something that you didn't even set out to think that it would be there, and you realize that it was there. For example, in the mobile and micro trading study that we did, we realized that the mobile phone is sometimes some market traders buy mobile phones for their workers, and sometimes it goes against them. Why? Because the worker now becomes empowered and start talking to your competitors. So it's not always advisable to empower your own employee with a mobile phone, which we found in the different, when we came to Ghana, we didn't see that as a problem. But when we went to Nigeria, we see that as a problem. So you see, there are differences in the study. And maybe the reason why there was a problem could be that the cultural patterns, that maybe people are more faithful to their business partners or their madams in Ghana as compared to Nigeria. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. Good. So how do these lessons relate to your theoretical framework? That's what you do. So what happens in your conclusion? Conclusion has 3 parts. The first part has to do with the summary of your study. What did I find in my study? And then I can revisit my hypothesis and my research questions. Implications is the second one, and the last one is future research directions. It means that what is the takeaway? What can we package from this work? So that means that we look at a few words, what did your study do? And how was it? What has it achieved? What methods were used? What hypotheses were confirmed or unconfirmed? What are the new or key lessons? So you say that you can write it like this. The study set out to achieve this and that and that. Using the framework, we did this and this. The findings tend to suggest that, 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 that. So now what is the way forward? That's what you do in your summary part. So look at an example, knowledge transfer in and between projects. We began this long essay with the quest of determining how organizations can learn and transfer knowledge in and between technology projects. To this quest, we drew on the theory of meaning structures in organizations, which was extended into a theoretical framework, the organizational learning cycle, as a means of facilitating a transformational learning process within technology projects and generating knowledge definable into actions which maximize success in technology projects. Evaluating this framework within a case study, we gain empirical evidence to strengthen its internal validity. At this stage, we ask ourselves, what is the way forward? This is even a brief one, because somebody can even go to tell you what the framework led to or what are the findings that came from the work. But what is he doing? He's trying to summarize what he did, how he did it, and what are the key things that come out from his work. So part of it is that you also continue on. And say, in our literature review, we propose a research framework which suggests this and this. However, the discussion and analysis of our findings tend to bring the following new insights and confirmations to earlier propositions or hypotheses. So the first insight, is it a confirmation or not a confirmation? Second, third, fourth. Some students, if you don't have hypotheses, you can use your research questions to guide you to answer these things. So you do this one is about 500 to about 800 words, if possible, if it's that long. And sometimes some students revisit their research framework. They'll tell you, they'll redraw it and tell you which of them. You know, if you had 7 factors and only 5 were sufficient, were confirmed, you redraw it with only the 5. And then you write maybe the significance level by it. You see them in some studies. They'll draw it and they'll put the, it was significant as 0.04. You know, if it's 0.05, it's significant and below. But if it's above that, it's not significant. So people will read, some students will read, or some authors will redraw the model and then put the significance levels. That's if quantitative. If it is qualitative, they'll just draw, this was the beginning, then they'll draw the next one and put in the new variable, the new issues that they have found. You see, now you have put in certain things inside here to tell you, if you compare to the old one, there's nothing there. But if you look at the new one, there is something there. So you read, you see, some people write it like revisiting the research framework and then tell you, or research model, tell you what was confirmed and what is not confirmed. Now, some people do it in paragraphs, some people do it in sections. It's up to you. Okay. Then after that, they move to the implications to research practice and policy. Implication, how does it inform the research area? Who will it benefit? This is actual benefits and implication, not potential. In the research proposal, you do potential, but in this case, you are doing the actual. So let's look at an example here. Concerning, this is micro trading and mobiles. Concerning research implications, the conceptual framework figure 1 extends the knowledge on the application of transaction cost theory in information systems. So what does it achieve? Previous research has posited 2 arguments. First, transaction cost theory tend to focus on how cost aspects of transactions, on the cost aspects of transaction, whilst being silent on the transaction benefits. Our conceptual framework in response goes beyond transaction cost to discuss transaction benefits, which stem from adoption and use of mobile phones. So it's telling you the contribution are brought. These transaction benefits are discussed at the level of a micro trading entity, which could be either an individual or a business or organization. The findings from this research explain how transaction benefits are influenced by the frequency of usage of mobile phones by actors in transaction. The framework also explains how transaction benefits lead to incremental and transformational effects in micro trading activities. Tell you the benefits from there. Now look at concerning implications to practice. The conceptual framework tends to be a response to Duncombe and Wharton call for theoretically inspired frameworks which go beyond examining design and adoption to identify the needs and assess impact in mobile for development initiatives. In fact, the argument here is that previous studies don't give us the models that combine how to be able to look at needs and assess impact to how to design. So most often the studies are adoption of mobile phones without looking at impact of mobile phones, or the need for mobile phones for somebody without looking at impact. So this study tried to combine almost all the things, the use, the need, and then the impact. And that's what it's trying to explain. Authors argue that due to the complexity of influencing factors, practitioners and researchers alike find it challenging to conceptualize needs and assess impact with a single model. This study attempts to enable practitioners to conduct such an assessment by providing a conceptual framework as a starting point. So now, if authors and researchers are going to carry out an examination, then they need to look at the why you adopt mobile phones and what you use it for, and the impact you get from it. You can use this model. Implication to policy. Our attention is drawn to the complex interrelationship between mobile phone adoption and inclusion in the information economy. That's inequalities of being able, that separates somebody from using a mobile phone and not using the mobile phone. Now, micro enterprises and micro traders play a central role in economic activities of developing countries. They are a source of employment but often score poorly on sustainability. We discussed, you have heard of these things before. Good. Now, as our findings indicate, the emphasis is on quality of usage of the innovative quality of usage or the innovative use of mobile functions and services. Improving access to and quality of usage of mobile phones and services may help narrow the digital gaps which exist in resource poor countries or contexts. What it's trying to say is that if we improve the access to the mobile phone and improve quality of usage, that people are able to use it, like use the actual applications on the phone, then you are bridging the gap between those who use and those who don't get any benefits from mobile phone. Because most of the time, those who are not getting benefits from the mobile phone is because they are not finding an innovative use for their lives. So if you can enable them to do it better, that gap will be what? Narrowed. And for micro traders especially, when they apply to their business, it's likely that it will reduce those occurrence of unsustainability and increase occurrence of what? Sustainability. If the mobile phone expands your business, helps you to meet new clients, and then what does it do? It increases, opens up your revenue that helps you to sustain your business. So policy initiatives to address digital divide or foster digital inclusion may as well as consider enhancing quality of usage of such services beyond merely improving access. Most of the time, governments think that it's all about just increasing access, reducing the cost of the mobile phone, reducing cost of tariffs just alone. But sometimes you can reduce cost of mobile phone and reduce tariffs. But if people don't know how to use the applications on the phone, you come back to square one. That's not true. Because if you don't take care, it will reduce them to only using voice calls. But a mobile phone with its data applications can do more than what? Voice calls. And if you look at where you are going in terms of mobile phone usage, value exists more in data services than just voice in the future. Because the frequency of data services that you, the frequency and expenditure is higher than the voice. What the cost of 1 megabyte per second, and look at the cost of 1 call per second. Data will go higher than what? Voice. And if you increase data usage by having more government services on the mobile phone, what will happen? Or government internet service on mobile phone, it will increase usage, and then it will increase revenues for even the mobile companies. And when mobile companies' revenues increase, taxes that government gets is goes out high. So that's a very good relationship. Now, future research direction. In relation to your findings, what should future research do? Acknowledge the limitations of your study and then highlight what new future research should do. So look at this, adoption of telemedicine in Rwanda. The study makes a case that future research strategies and policies in telemedicine in developing countries should have broader and long-term perspectives to ensure sustainability of telemedicine initiatives. A broader perspective requires the evaluation of how technologies which have low-cost adoption and diffusion, like mobile phones, can be adapted for medical practices in resource-poor contexts. While this may not be applicable to all medical disciplines, low-cost innovations like mobile phones may be appropriate path towards developing sustainable telemedicine initiatives, one which can adapt to the resource constraints of developing countries. What it's saying here is that future policies or future research should explore how low-cost innovations, which are easily diffusible in developing countries like mobile phones, can be used for medical services. Because you see, telemedicine is giving medical services over a distance, and most of them try to give it over the internet or try to give it over video conferencing. So it means that if you are doing an operation here, somebody can be watching it and giving you direction. But you see, if you come to developing countries, our internet services are challenged, our technology infrastructure is challenged, but our poverty situations are high, so going to the hospital is difficult, and our infrastructure in terms of road and physical access to healthcare is also challenged. Sometimes you have to cross 3 rivers to get to the nearest hospital. So if you want to be able to empower people to manage their medical services better, then it means that we should use low-cost innovations that are accessible to them. For example, you can even give somebody a blood monitoring, blood pressure monitoring kit, that as soon as he takes his blood pressure, he can text the blood pressure results to a mobile service. That maybe the recipient at the other end is a nurse or a doctor who can be monitoring, so that when your blood pressure is going high, he can know incidences of what, hypertension. Especially for a community that you know that they are quite hypertensive, this could be very, very good way of monitoring. I saw that in Cameroon, where local doctors and nurses were empowered with mobile phones, and then hypertensive agents patients were given their kits. They measure every morning and then text it, so that the doctor will plot it and then know when an occurrence can be, or whether you're taking your meds well, and then your progress. So that could be one of the innovations that could be done, and he is asking for more studies to be done in that area. Good. Now, reference citations. When you finish your long essay, you have to do your citation. Your citation is supposed to follow what is required of your university. In a business school in the University of Ghana, we focus on APA style. So we expect you to do APA style, not Harvard style, APA style. So make sure that you know APA style, and there's a link for downloading it. It's also in the research book. Last part, writing an abstract. What goes into an abstract? An abstract is just an overview of what you did, an executive summary of what you did and how you did it and what came out of the work. So in writing an abstract, there are some guidelines. We want to see the purpose, the method, the findings, the implications, and originality. What, why, how, and whom, who or who benefits. Now these are the elements of an abstract. For a long essay or in some papers, your abstract may be as long as 250 words or as short as 100 words. So let's look at an example. Purpose asks, what are the reasons for doing this long essay or the aims of the research? Method, it means that where do you collect your data from and where, how do you collect your data? What methods were used? Findings are what was found in your study, and then implications is what, how does it inform research policy and practice? You may not be able to cover all of them, so doing the research implications, and sometimes one of them, practice or policy, may be helpful. Then originality is that what is new in the paper and what is the value to who? Sometimes your paper is perhaps the first attempt of doing such a thing in your work in this area. For example, if your study is about the impact of wearables on consumer behavior, like mobile wearables, like the watches that are coming up, on consumer choices in Ghana, or consumer choice and wearables in Ghana, your study could be one of the first of its kind, even in West Africa. And nobody would have done such a study like that. Okay, so look at an example like this. The adoption of telemedicine in Rwanda, the abstract for it. The research presents a case study of adoption. You see, I've told you the method already. A case study of adoption of mobile telemedicine in Rwanda. Telemedicine offers a new set of new and innovative health solutions which have a promise to resource poor environments. Somebody could have actually begun with this one before he states this one, but it's all the same. Now, this finding suggests that, now we are moving to findings. Commitment of government to telemedicine and strategic choice of using low cost and less complex technologies and strategic partnerships with educational and technology companies are factors which have influenced the telemedicine implementation in Rwanda. It's telling you what he found in Rwanda. Then he goes on to say the study concludes that low cost innovations which are adaptable to resource constraints in developing countries may be appropriate path towards developing sustainable telemedicine initiatives, what we discussed just now. This should be the agenda for future research and strategies. You see, one thing is missing. He didn't talk about the originality of the work. He should have said this work is one of the first of its kind in that. Sometimes the number of words can limit you, so you should focus on what you can focus on. If that is the case, then what should you focus on? Somebody will ask. I would advise that you focus on your purpose, your method, your findings, and your implications. Originality can be mentioned if there's space. But for a long essay, as a student in the University of Ghana, it's easy. You can add originality. Try to find out what is original of your work. Something, your originality can lie in the method you use. It's the first of its kind, which have done mobile phone studies in Ghana by looking at the elderly. That could be your originality. So originality can come out. But please, this is what we call a structured abstract. We don't use structured abstract unless you are submitting a paper to Emerald. Most abstracts they don't have the headings. They just put them together like this. So please, use the headings to guide you to write it. After that, remove the headings from there. Headings are called structured abstract, usually done in the Emerald database. If you see every paper you download in Emerald, you see, as of now, you know what Emerald is. If you don't know Emerald, go and watch episode 2 and episode 3. It will help you. Okay. Now, before submitting your long essay, this is important to us. If you have said anything throughout the semester or throughout the time of engagement, this is the most important part. First of all, check your structure and presentation. Please, sentences should have full stop. Sentences should have full stop. Okay. Check your references. That you're using the same referencing style. Somebody asked me, can I use both Harvard and APA? Doesn't make sense. Stick to one style of reference. Each paragraph presenting a key argument should have a reference. I argue that every 50 words should have a reference, and every 100, 200 words should have at least 3 other references. That means that you don't repeat the same person 4 times. So they should have different references, and you don't follow the same reference again in a paragraph. Kwame 2009 and Kwame 2009 again. In between the two Kwame 2009, bring Boateng 2005. I hope you understand me. Otherwise, it looks like you are reading from only one author. Make sure every page has a reference. Don't go with long paragraphs without references. Unless you are in your findings and you are presenting a case study. And in that case, your reference is the case itself, the case you want to collect. The quotations in the case are your reference. So make sure that every page has a reference. Even conclusion, references should be there. Some students have the idea that conclusion shouldn't have any reference. Even conclusion should have references to echo. You see, when I was doing the research implication, showing that my work is connecting with somebody's work and going beyond that. So it's important that references are in your work from beginning to end. Okay. Now, don't begin sentences with brackets. It is not done. It's wrong. How will you read this? Bracket argues that. It doesn't make sense. Know where to position your full stop. The full stop shouldn't be before the bracket. It should be at the end of the bracket. Otherwise, we don't know whether the reference is for this sentence or for that sentence. Like, the price of goods does not affect inflation. Look at where is the full stop. The full stop is in front of the bracket. It doesn't make sense. Don't put initials in your inline referencing, in in-text referencing. No initial like this. Mensa, comma J. We don't need a J. J should be in the list of references. This is a common mistake that we all do. So take it out from there. Paragraphing. This is not a paragraph. Writing your sentences and then moving to the next line is not a paragraph. A paragraph, this is wrong. Some of you do double spacing or singles 1.5. So you think this is a paragraph. It's not a paragraph. If you are doing the UK paragraphing, then they should be able to put a cursor here in between the two paragraphs. So this is not a paragraph. It's not a paragraph. Usually when you are doing, when you are using Word and you are using double spacing or 1.5 space, it implies that you have done a paragraph. It's not a paragraph. This is also not a paragraph. Okay. Now this is what a paragraph looks like. You see, I can put the cursor there. Good. So be careful about what you are doing. Now this is how your long essay is marked. Relevance to topic or MBA program, 5 marks. Usually we don't give all the 5, 4. So you have to know that your topic is too far from the relevance to MBA program. So MIA student doing something on financing of fishing companies in Ghana. It doesn't make sense. You get 2 or 1 year. Then organize, unless you are operations. Yeah. Organization and structure and layout. You see, when you bring your work and your full stops are not there. Some of you start from 2.1, then you move to 2.25. Where is all the in between? Where are the numbering? You don't do that. Some of you number. When you get to some things, you don't number anymore. So you number and number and number, then you stop numbering. Then you continue numbering again. Well, does it make sense? Header 1 is header 1. Header 2 is header 2. Header 3 is header 3. It's me, I would advise you that don't be going to header 4. It makes the thing cumbersome. Unless you need to. And that is apparently, it's only advisable when you are doing maybe literature review or maybe analysis, because you have the lot of factors you are looking at. But even that, if you can combine them. Mm-hmm. Evidence of familiarity with literature concepts. Have you quoted the lecturer who supervised you? No, not that one. But it's important. Have you quoted the relevant authors in that area, in Ghana, in Africa, and global? Some of you quote all the global, but you don't quote anybody in Ghana on that topic. It's not good. Try and do that. Or within your country, or the context of study. Okay. Now, background to the study is important. Have you done all these things? That means that if there's some statistic, for example, how can you do mobile phone penetration study in Ghana and never tell us about what NCA statistics say? It doesn't make sense. You have not read enough. Then, methodology and sampling and data gathering. 10 marks. You see, if you choose methods in your methodology and you don't justify where you choose them, we don't give you good marks. So if you start getting half, you are going to get 50. Below 60 is fail. So you don't want to get below 60. Data management analysis. Some of you just do tables and just leave the tables there. No analysis and telling us what the tables tell us. So you do, and you do tables. The funny thing I don't like about students is that they'll do a table, they'll put a table there. 5 said yes, 10 said no. Then they'll go and do a pie chart of that 5 said yes, 10 said no. And then they'll go and do a bar chart of it again. When you have the table, don't do a pie chart and do a bar chart again. Choose one. They are all data display methods. Either you are using a table or a bar chart. In fact, the pie should, I don't like pie in my view. Unless there's a need for you to do pie, don't do pie. If you Google when to use pie chart in Google, it will tell you. But I advise you stick to tables. But sometimes your table shouldn't be always yes and no. Sometimes you do cross-tabulation. Cross-tabulation can tell you differences
across a variable than just putting
yes, no, yes, no. Now, if you are giving demographics, don't give a table for male and female, a table for how many went to school, high school. You can present one big table and then arrange it in such a way that all of them will come in it. If you look at some published papers, you see that they use some style. They put the variables on one side and they just put the thing there. You see that they write it there in rows. So you can write male 10, female 20 in a one row instead of doing it into what? A column. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. They present one table to have all the statistics in there. The basic statistics, marriage, what again? In the industry. No, if it's about individual marriage, sex, education, and then maybe age. This, you see, all of them can come in one table. Some students would rather do a write up age of the respondents where then they do it again. Then they do another one for how many were born in Accra, how many were in Accra. Oh, please don't do those things. Use a simple table to summarize it so that you can focus on the issues by doing cross tabulations. Then acknowledgement of sources, those who do not appropriate referencing, mixing references. Now, if somebody gives you half year, you automatically get half year. Ideally, if you don't have the, if you have got poor reference in your paper, that means that you are getting weak. Your evidence is what is not there. What is referencing? The act of providing evidence for your argument. So if this is weak, this also what will be what? Weak. Then, for main findings and contribution to knowledge. Very, very important. That is why I say don't rush conclusion. You see how I was giving the different parts of conclusion. Some students just go straight to implications and then recommendations. Don't rush conclusions. I didn't mention recommendation. My recommendations are also very, very important. After you have done your implications, recommendations is to the organization or the sector. Direct action words to them. Not generic one, direct one to them. Okay. So main findings and contribution. This one I'm going to check. You see, when you are marking this, I check both your conclusion and then your analysis and findings to see whether any things come up. That's why you see that sometimes I tell students to pull out the lessons, either in a table or a summary, lesson one, finding two. Summarize them. Make sure that there's in the summary of the chapter called analysis and conclusion, the summary findings are put in a table or somewhere there. Because sometimes the chapter is so long, by the time you finish reading it as a supervisor, you can't even remember what were the key findings there. Summarize them in that summary. You can use a table to outline them. It even helps you so that when you move to conclusion, say in reference to table something, there are five key findings and five new insights or something like that. You see, when you do that, it means that you are even bold enough to identify what was found in your work. Some students leave it in the discussion that you, the lecturer, should find what to identify the good ones out of it. I should identify the good ones. Then I'll identify it with my marks and carry my marks away. But if you want to get the marks, please do the writing. Conclusion and recommendations is very, very important. Conclusion, I've talked about it, 10 marks. So don't rush it. You see, this alone is 25 marks. That's one quarter of your study. And then you see, and then this alone is what? Another almost one quarter. So if you are weak here, data management, if you are going to be weak here, your work is failed. Look at it. 10 plus 7 plus 5. You're not getting 50. So be very careful. This is how we mark your long essay. Not MPhil, but I think undergrad and then the MBA program. This is how we mark an MSc program. Your work is going to be challenged. That is why we are telling you to follow all these techniques. It matters. Because when we look at it, you are doing basic research. Means that we look at the rigor at arriving at your answers. So it's very, very important that you adhere to all of this. But don't be scared. You should know that if you put a good effort, you get a good mark. Thank you very much. Okay.